Hey guys, it's Matty and I'm stood in a garage where the mechanics here are qualified and have everything they need to fix every make and model of car virtually that's on the road. Well, nearly every one of them. If you'd have told an old man 50 or so years ago that in 40 or so years we'd have these electric cars available to drive, he'd have probably believed you. But if you'd have told him they'd look like this, well, he probably would have fell off his chair, wet himself, and died. But life goes on, for some anyway.
This is the BMW i3, the brand's quirky entry to the subcompact electric car market back in 2013.
I say quirky, it's not really, is it? I mean, yeah, it looks like nothing else on the road, but most electric cars look like nothing else on the road. The difference with the i3 is that it looks different, but it still remains sophisticated. Something only the Germans can master. The i3 is a hipster girl that doesn't look completely bonkers. It's alternative, but it carries itself really well.
In here, there's a real touch of grand designs about the interior. You can even have Kevin MacLeod as the sat-nav voice. And instead of just using the same rehashed interior design like they do in all BMWs, BM have actually designed a really bespoke, exclusive interior for the i3. In fact, the only thing that's rehashed is the materials they've used for the interior. They're recyclable. For example, here on the dashboard and on the door card, it kind of looks like an old primary school carpet, but it feels like repurposed cardboard. There's lots of cool design features as well, like this Coke can style rocker unit to change the gears. Now that's lifted straight out of an old Citroen. Another thing that you'll find in an old Citroen, or basically any car from an olden time, is this completely flat floor. I love it. That's about one of the only electric car design innovations that I can really get behind.
In fact, the whole design language inside the i3 is about as uncomplicated as you're ever gonna get on a modern car. There's also plenty of features available that we now come to expect on modern cars, such as sat-nav, reversing camera, and climate control.
Another feature that you get on the BMW i3 are these suicide doors, just like in a Mazda RX-8, or a Vauxhall Mariva, depending on your state of mind.
Now, if I was being harsh, I'd say that space in the back of the i3 is a little bit tight. Now, if we do the lanky Matty test, where we imagine that there's two Matties sat behind each other, God forbid, we can see that there isn't an awful lot of leg room. And also, you can't really put your feet under the seat or anywhere. You're just sort of sat with your knees nearly behind your ears. Headroom, though, it's not too bad. But if I wasn't being harsh, then I'd say that the type of person that, from what I can gather, will buy the i3 and who has bought the i3 isn't the type of person who is a busy mum with a couple of kids looking to get out of a one series into one of these. So there we go. Practicality doesn't matter.
Now, up to now, you may think I've been being a little bit kind to the BMW i3. Maybe a little bit too kind, but don't worry. A shitstorm is incoming. But for now, I'm going to carry on kissing BMW's batteries for just a minute longer. Now, you really can't argue with the performance in the i3, 0 to 60 in 7 seconds, and the response from the engine when you just push the accelerator is shit hot. Do a little turn and circle test. Oh yes, that's good. And again. The turning circle is brilliant. I wasn't even on full lock then. Another thing we've got in this car is regenerative braking. Now that makes reverse parking a little bit difficult because the car's always trying to stop when you're just trying to get a little bit of momentum to really just squeeze into that space. But you do get a reversing camera, so you're never gonna crash. I was doing 46 miles an hour in a 40 zone before, and I know that doesn't sound like much, but it is bloody dangerous when you're driving and you think that you're doing the speed limit and you're not. Even now I'm doing 37 in a 30, you know, you just can't help it. I think it's because you can't hear the engine giving any strain that you just think that you're all right. Now, I'd like to think I'm a petrol head, and that I like petrol cars and that I wouldn't have an electric car. But one thing you must realise when you drive an electric car is that you're not craving a petrol engine all the time. You're just sort of enjoying the ride, enjoying the silence, the just seamless, nice, effortless electricity vibe. Now, obviously that wears off, but so does driving an uncomfortable track car, you know? The ride is a little bit firm, but not back-breakingly so. The iFreeze ride may not be back-breaking, but it is bank-breaking. Let's pull over and do some maths. The iFree cost £33,000 to buy new, but if you take £5,000 off that for the now discontinued government grant, then you're left with £28,000.
No matter how space-aged the i3 is, £28,000 for a four-seat hatchback with an old carpet on the dash sounds a bit dodgy to me. Especially when on electric power alone, the i3 can only take you around 80 miles.
The 0.6-litre petrol engine, which I can't seem to open the cap off, does boost the range by about 200 miles, until your 2 gallons of fuel are gone and you have to fill up again. Now, the range extender is a little bit pointless to me. It's like BMW replaced the inconvenience of a poor battery life with the inconvenience of a small fuel tank. You must have been an absolute mug to pay £30,000 for one of these new. The i3 is now available on the used car market with prices starting at around £9,000. So if you're looking for a premium, well-handling, let's face it, really cool electric car, then that's where the BMW i3 makes sense.